Alright guys, so now that you recharged the batteries, right? Okay, we call this when you eat and get an energy like this, you know how we call it in English? This kind of energy? No? It's called sugar buzz. Is you eat some carbohydrates, it raises your blood sugar level and it makes you feel good. Gives you a feeling of energy. Alright, back to, back to rest. Or now you got sugar buzz, also makes you excited, feel good and energetic. Now you can do hundreds of other things except focus. Right, so try and stay focused. I mean, so I covered section number 2, the market portfolio. We did the systematic risk. The other one is called holy. One more, pay attention. If this is systematic, this is called unsystematic. Unsystematic risk. Alright, so we got a whole bunch of names, like 5 different names for the same thing, okay? Unsystematic. Alright, so now let's write out something very simple, very common sense, but we gotta write to make sure that everybody understands that's total risk. So, total risk is simply systematic risk, which is this portion, plus choose one, diversifiable, unsystematic. Is this visible here? Alright, page 254, equation 3. Come on guys, I need you for assistance, right? You got it. Alright, so, then I covered diversification and unsystematic risk. So, we can cover it like this. This risk here can be diversified. I already covered that. Now, what is the source? What is the source of systematic risk? In other words, why there is a risk that you can't diversify? Well, these are economy-wide. These are risks associated with the whole economy. If the whole economy goes down, well, obviously, revenues for most companies will go down. Obviously, profits for most companies will go down. Obviously, the stock prices will go down. So, these are risks associated with the economy. In other words, the economy affects all stocks almost equally. The second one part of the economy, which is almost the same, is interest rates. Most companies borrow, and most companies are affected by interest rates. So, interest rates affect practically all companies. If interest rates change, they change for the whole economy and they change for all companies in the stock market. Okay? Or, of course, bonds too. Interest rates affect bond values too. Alright? So that's another example where. Alright, here's another. Easy one. Affects everything. Taxes. If taxes change and you just raise taxes on all companies, that's going to crash the stock market. Well, did we have something like this with Trump or not? When Trump was elected, he said, I'm going to lower taxes for all companies. And then the stock market shot up big time. In other words, when the stock market hears higher taxes, it is scared and crashes. But if the stock market loves lower taxes, means bigger profits, and stocks go up. So, taxes. Now, you can use geopolitics, and the favorite one is called war, okay? It could be tariffs, it could be... In other words, there are things in the economy that affect practically all companies in the stock market, okay? What could be it? Oh yeah, I forgot, let's write it out. Currency, exchange rate. Let's say you're a British company. Exchange rate affects practically all British companies. All right? Meaning the exchange rate of the British pound.
Euro.
Exchange rate affects practically all European companies. Almost equally. Of course, some have more exports, some have more imports. But overall, they affect everybody. So these are factors that somehow affect all companies and affect the whole market altogether. All right, so I covered that part over here. And we get to the next little section called beta. Systematic risk, I already covered. The next section is systematic risk and beta. Hopefully you got some energy, right? Hey, does coffee give you energy? Coffee give you energy?
Yes.
If you're a coffee drinker, right? What's the mechanism?
Coffee?
Yeah.
It just boosts your metabolism.
Oh, it boosts your metabolism. In other words, it boosts your adrenal glands. In the adrenal gland, when it raises the adrenaline gets the effect and raises blood sugar. So it's an alternative way of giving you a sugar buzz. Not as fast. Now, if you load the coffee with some sugar, then it's a double effect. It's a double sugar buzz. All right, back to you guys ready? Beta. Well, what is the beta? Beta is a measure of risk. It works as follows. Page 256. All right, let's go a little bit this way. 256. There's a nice little figure, number. Figure number 3. And it looks as follows. You got the, I should have drawn it here, because you may have negative returns. Let's say here on the one end is the market. This is the stock market return, and here is your favorite stock. What's the stock? HD, standing for high definition, right? We all now do high definition video recording, right? On your phones? Well, here's Home Depot, but it can put any other company. And stock market gave you some return, and the stock gave you a little better. In other words, if this is plus 2, this is going to be plus 4. Next time, stock market gave you high return, but your stock didn't give you as much. Next time, the stock market gave you the return, and you got a little bit of a return. And you plot every day or every week, you plot the stock market's return against the stock's return. Okay? How do we call this thing? We did this in business analytics many times, right? Every time you got some data, You just draw the chart like that. Okay? You basically draw plot by plot. It's very easy. It takes, for a good student, 5 seconds. All right? You just do the plot. And then, remember what we did next time? Next we did is draw the correlation. So, we draw a straightforward. Now, you may have some negative observations. That's okay. So, you draw the correlation line. We did that too. That's built into the software. And the correlation line looks like this. Okay, this is known as the, technically, regression. Regression line. Alright, and what's the regression line? It is y equals alpha plus beta x. Alright, so this is y is our stock, okay, which is Home Depot, and we regress it up against the market. Alright, we regress it up against the market. Alright, and alpha is here where you cross, and beta is the angle. Well, this beta here is the same as this beta. So this is just written as beta. That's how we call it. That's how it's read. Alright? So basically this beta tells you the relationship between the market and the stock. Okay. Alright, now let's provide a couple of examples. I'm going to redraw this chapter here, and so that you can now see how to interpret the beta. I'm going to give you three different charts. This is chart number one. This is chart or regression line number two. And now we go with regression line number three. And this is the market. And this is some stock, HD, high definition, right? So, now it's a simple question. If the stock market is up, let's say 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, it could be sigma, it could be percent. Let's just use percent. 1%, 2%, 3%, 4%, 5%. If stock market's up 1%, okay, first one. Number one. Stock market is plus 1%. How much is the stock up? The stock is up about 2. All right. So a stock market goes up 1, the stock goes up 2. This is a straight line. If the stock market is 2, what about the stock? Let me see. Is it visible or not visible? Maybe. 4. If it's 3, stock is 6. Okay? And if it's 4 is 8. So the beta is the ratio between the two. The beta is the ratio between the two. If the stock market goes up by 3.5, this is 7. So the beta is 2. In other words, the stock is twice more volatile. What it means? It means if the stock market is minus 3, the stock will be minus 6. Okay? If the stock market is minus 10 this year, this stock will be minus 20. So, whatever the market gives you, this gives you twice bigger. If it gives you twice bigger, it's got twice the risk. So, this beta is a measure of risk. Okay? Is a measure of risk. And beta equal 2 means twice the risk of the market. Okay. Looks good, is it? Number 2. Curve number 2. Plus 1. What's the other one? What's the stock? Plus 1. Plus 3, what's the stock?
Plus 3.
Minus 7. Minus 7. And beta is?
1.
Wow, that was easy. No, easy, not amazing. That was easy. Alright, and now? And now, curve number 3. Plus 1. What happens?
Plus
0.5. Plus 0.5. You see, we got a candidate for a bonus point here. Next. Plus 4. Plus 2. Minus 3, minus 1.5. Now here, I draw the lines through the origin. But I could draw the line a little bit higher, okay? But you get the idea. What matters is the slope. So here the beta is
0.5.
So, summarize. The first stock has twice the risk of the market. The second stock has the same risk as the market. And the third stock has half the risk of the market. Let's draw the picture over here. This stock here will be 1/2. This is the stock number 3. This stock here will be 1. Okay? And this stock here will be 2. Alright? So it's the slope that matters. Is it clear so far? Little break? Questions? So far? Alright, let's see what I covered. I covered section, that's page 255. This is page 255. Systematic risk and beta. 256. Alright. Next. Page 257. But I can delete this stuff here. All right. Next step. Portfolio beta. All right, guys, pay attention. This is where the problems come for the quiz and for the midterm. This is one of the most important relationships in finance. And it is important because it's simple and amazingly easy. This is what makes it very good. So, portfolio beta is written as beta P, P standing for portfolio, beta of the portfolio, is simply the weight of stock number one multiplied by its beta, beta of the first stock times its weight, plus stock two multiplied by the beta stock 3 weight of 3 times its beta plus dot 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 plus if you have n stocks 10 or 20 times its beta n where 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus dot 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 plus n equals 1. So W is a weight. Okay? Is that very clear? So beta of a portfolio measures the risk of a portfolio is a simple weighted average. Now, I already did for the late arrivals in previous hour where I already gave you the expected return of a portfolio. The expected return of a portfolio is simply weight one times expected return of the first one plus weight two, the expected return of the second asset plus dot 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 weight n expect return of R N. So the expected return of a portfolio is a weighted average of each element. And the risk of a portfolio is the weighted average of its betas. That's the genius of the capital asset pricing model, is that it provides simple, easy, straightforward measure of risk, and the risk adds up. If you got three stocks, you weight the risks. If you have five stocks, you weight the risk. So a portfolio's got a stock beta 1 equal 1 and beta 2 equal 3. And if the weights are equal, the beta of the portfolio will be 2. Very simple. That's the genius of this portfolio theory. Provides simple, easy measures. That covered the piece of 257 and section complete. Questions? All right, page 258. Page 258. SML and CAPM. What is SML? SML stands for All right, guys, please pay attention. Security. Market line. All right, and I already covered capital asset pricing model. Well, what is the security market line? Security market line is You guys ready?
Yes.
Security market line simply tells you the beta of a portfolio. It could be the beta of a stock. In other words, we put in here risk, and over here we put in return. All right. Remember, this is the most fundamental relationship in finance. This is the foundation of finance. We started chapter one, and I started explaining that the two pillars of finance are time value of money and risk and return. Time value of money means the sooner you get the money, the more valuable it is. And the risk return says the higher the risk, the higher the return. And when the risk is zero, you still require some return. I mean, you still gotta get it. Even at zero risk, you still wanna have 3, 4, 5, 6%, whatever, 10, maybe 2, okay? Well, this part here is called RFR. Standing for risk free rate. This is the interest rate, the same as rate of return when there is no risk. In other words, the return required when risk is zero. This one is zero risk. There is no negative risk. Negative risk is impossible. And return, nobody's going to take a negative return. You're just going to take cash and sit on it. So when you take a cash and sit on it, your return on cash is zero. Now, governments try desperately to get negative returns and bonds turning negative returns so people can actually lose money so that the government can actually make money. But that's another topic for another course when you take investments. So this is the risk-free rate, okay? And then you got the security market line, goes like this, SML. And it has a property that the security market line is a line, meaning it's linear. Line means that when you double the risk, you also gotta double the return over here. So, if this is how it goes, okay, this is one unit of risk, this is one piece of return. For one extra unit of risk, you get required the same return, extra return. For 3 units of risk, you require the same units of return. Okay? So, from this point on, doubling the risk will require double the extra return. 3 times the risk, 3 times the return. 5 times the risk is 5 times the return. Okay? So, the return, let's say, to a portfolio will be equal to this RFR. RFR. Sometimes RFR, we just say write it as RF. That's how textbooks like to write it too. RF. Risk free. Okay? Or return risk free. So just say RF. RF. Plus, what's here? 1, 2, 3. What is this 1, 2, 3?
Risk.
Measured by
beta.
So you say beta times this slope. And this slope we call risk premium. Risk premium. RP. Risk premium. So it goes like this. RP, let's write it out here. RP. So, what is risk premium? Risk premium is the return or the premium, the return for taking risk. And risk premium is the interest or the return that you get for taking beta equal to 1. But what is beta equal to 1? Let's write it out. Beta equal to 1 is the same as market risk. Market risk. So the risk premium is the return for taking market risk. Alright. And let's say risk premium is, alright, let's do it again. Simple and easy problem. Suppose the RFR is 3%. Sounds about right. And suppose that the risk premium, taking the stock market risk premium, is let's say 8%. So take the RFR to be 3%. Take the risk premium. Oh, this is, guys, this is RP, my mistake. RP, not RP. Take it 8%, okay? And now the question is, what's the stock with these parameters? What is a stock, the same applies for a portfolio, with a beta of half? So, if this is risk, this is return, the risk is beta, and it's half. When it a stock has a risk half the market, what's going to be the return? It's going to be 3 plus half of 8% is 4. So it becomes 3 plus 4, 7. Well, what if the risk is beta equal to 1? Becomes 3 plus 8 equal 11. Well, what if risk is 1.5? 3 plus 12? 15. Some stocks could be very, very risky. They can easily have a beta of 3. That's perfectly realistic. Many mining stocks could have a beta of 5. Okay? Oil exploration stocks. So, what will be the expected the expected risk. Sorry, expected return. What will be the expected return? 3 times 8? 24. Becomes 27. So, the stock will have very high expected return, but also a very high probability of taking a big loss too. Alright? So, big returns comes with risks for big losses. Alright, let me see what else I got to complete this section. So, this equation, okay, red color. This equation here is the capital asset pricing model. The capital asset pricing model tells you that the expected return of an asset or portfolio of assets is the risk-free rate plus the beta, in other words, its risk multiplied by its the risk premium, the market risk premium. All right, so that's the capital asset pricing model. And the security market line is simply a chart of the model. It's simply a graph. So SML is just a chart, a graph, a picture of the capital asset price. So SML is the graphical representation of the capital asset pricing model. All right. You just see what it is. All right. Now, simple question. If this is where they are, if you got a stock here, would this be attractive to buy or attractive to sell? If you got a stock that gives you like this, is this attractive buy or sell? All right, let's go back here. What about this one? This is very obvious, guys. This gives you tiny little return for a lot of risk. This is no good. You just sell. Let's give you now a nicer one. Easy, okay? You want easy. This is a huge return for a tiny little risk. So all of this area here is a buy area, meaning undervalued. All of this area here is a sell area, meaning little return for a lot of risk. This is a lot of return for a little risk, okay? You all want to get more return for less risk. All right, so we covered that part. And there is one last piece. One last piece is this. It's an easy piece. All right, so if you got 1 unit of risk, this here was the risk premium. The risk premium, or we called it, remember here, the risk premium also as market premium. Risk premium is the same as market premium. Okay? Now, the slope of this curve, which is premium, and here is risk. So you take the market premium divided by the risk, gives you the slope. So you divide this price by this price, okay? And it simply gives you premium to risk, okay? Well, the premium is return and risk. In other words, it tells you what's your return per unit of risk, or return to risk ratio. Return to risk ratio. So, return to risk ratio. Return to risk ratio. Now, the return is your reward for investing. So sometimes instead of return, they like the word reward. Reward to risk ratio. This is on page 259. Okay, so that part is covered. The market risk premium is covered. Okay, you got the portfolios. And that completes the whole chapter. Next time, homework, problems, chapter 8.